All right. Good morning, everybody. Welcome to church. So excited that everyone could be here this morning. Excited that God is holy and He loves us. So welcome, welcome, welcome. Got some exciting things taking place. As you guys are all excited about, which is good. Seen someone hand Connor some chocolate, so that's a good day for Connor. So just excited and blessed that you guys could be here this morning. Just a few announcements. Today, right after service, there's going to be a Peru meeting here in the sanctuary. So excited about that. Been working hard for any youth that want to go, adults that want to go. Just a trip for the church to go to Peru and love on kids. So excited about that. And if you have a desire for that and want some information about that, it would be a great time to come and see. Mark's put together some info on that. So today, 1 p.m., here in the sanctuary. So excited about that. As well as next week right after service, there's going to be a baptism. So it's pretty exciting that we could come to this place to celebrate and watch people get baptized. My son got baptized last year at the ripe age of 2. He just went underwater for the first time in the tub. So that was scary and exciting all at the same time. No, it's a great time just to come and celebrate, saying, hey, Jesus is Lord of my life. So if you want to be baptized, see Mark. If you're a teen that wants to be baptized, I'd love to baptize you, maybe hold you under the water a little bit longer. Excited about that, excited that there are people that say, hey, I want to get baptized. So looking forward to that. Tonight, youth group, there's going to be food and fun and time to study and time to grow in what God has made for us. And we are excited this morning. Everyone's excited to be here. So blessed by that. Couple more things. We will be, I won't announce this every week, but we have set the date for Mega Week, our youth summer camp that we had last year. We had over 65 kids last year. But we set the date for that for June 12th through 17th, and the theme is Greatness Awaits. So I am really, really excited to see what God has to bring in all that. The cost is going to be $50. 6th through 12th graders are welcome to come to that, and just truly excited because that's, I feel like, one of our bigger things we do, and just you guys get to get rid of your kids for a week long. So that'll be, yeah. So that's coming. Excited about that, and just truly excited about everything that God's doing. If I could just share something real quick with you guys, God hears our hearts and He loves us and He has a plan for each and every one of us. And just upstairs we have worship off and on, and something that's been so cool is I've just been trying to be faithful and praying for worship upstairs and what that's going to look like. And what I mean by that are people talented that plays instruments and things like that. And God knows where we're at, and I've just been praying because I didn't know the outcome, and it's still not figured out, but we just have an opportunity to where kids have started to learn how to play instruments, and you know, that wasn't by me because I can't do it, and so what's cool in all that is God put it on someone else's heart to say, hey, I want to teach kids this, and so super excited about that, blessed by that, and just, I say that this morning because whatever you're going through, no matter where you're at, if we're just faithful and obedient to praying and seeking God, He knows us. He knows our hearts. He knows our desires, and He hears us. He's there for us. So excited about all that. Excited that we can be here this morning. Let's pray. Lord, as we're all gathered here, as we're here today, God, You, Lord, remain the same. And You've never wavered. You've never changed, Lord, from just who You are, God. And that's King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And God, You reign over everything. Lord, and I thank You so much for that, God. And I thank You for the fact, God, that You just create us in Your image, Lord, and put great things inside of each and every one of us, Father. So, Lord, I pray that with everything that we have today, God, with our hearts, our minds, our thoughts, Lord, our words, God, just all that we are, no matter what we're going through, Lord, I pray that we're here today just to learn and grow in who You are, Lord, and who You desire us to be, God. So, Lord, I pray that You bless this offering, that Your will be done, Lord, and just God, as we go through so many different things in this world, day in and day out, God, Lord, I pray that we give those things to You, Lord, whether it's sickness, Lord, whether it's just, Lord, it feels like we just can't make it, Lord. But, Lord, we know that through You, God, all things are possible. So God, I pray that we would just lift everything we go through, the good and the bad, to you, Lord, and trust in you, Lord. And knowing that even if the mountains, even if things haven't moved or are still very present in our lives, God, know that you have a bigger plan and a purpose behind, Lord, just everything that you do, Lord. So I pray that you bless this time, Lord. Let us just love you with all that we got. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Lord, we ask that you be present here today and allow your people to move because there's power in your name. Let us all just realize how important you are to have in our lives and that you're always faithful.
I see the works of your hands, galaxies stand in a heavenly dance, oh God, all that you are, so overwhelming. I hear the sound of your voice. All at once it's a gentle and thundering noise, oh God. All that you are so overwhelming. You are the most beautiful,
and you are wonderful.
You are wonderful, you are wonderful. Oh God, there is no one more wonderful. You are wonderful,
God,
you are the most wonderful.
And you are glorious,
you are glorious, you are glorious. Oh God, there is no one more glorious. You are glorious, God, you are the most glorious. I delight myself in you, in the glory of your presence. I'm overwhelmed, I'm overwhelmed by you. God, I
because you are so beautiful.
Praise you, Lord.
You are my God.
Rescue us. You are our rescuer. You are our provider. You're our protector. We just thank you, God, for all the things you are in our lives.
Jesus, I need you, Jesus.
This world has nothing for me. follow you.
This world has nothing for me.
I'll always follow you.
Yes, Lord, this world has nothing for me. We need you, Lord. We need you every hour of every day, every minute, to lead us and guide us and help us with struggles. Or Lord, use us to help others with struggles. Let us see what you have for us to do, Lord. Step out diligently and do that for you, Lord. We need you in all that. Thank you for the breath that we breathe. Thank you for the beautiful sights we see that you provide for us, Lord. We lift you up. And with all that evidence, let us hear what you have for us, Lord. Speak to us mightily today in your holy name. Amen.
I'm sorry if I came across a little strong. Good to see you. Thanks for coming to church today. Thank you for coming. This is my wife, Jamie. Do you know that? You know my wife, Jamie? Everybody says, we don't know who your wife is.
It's because I try to hide.
My wife, Jamie, you want to say anything?
Good to have y'all this morning.
Neither here.
Everybody stay awake during preaching.
Yeah. Because I talk about the sleepers after church, don't I?
Yes, you do.
No, I don't. This is my wife, Jamie. Isn't that good to see her, don't you? Yeah? I did good. Didn't I do good? All right.
You got lucky.
I've tried for years. Rejected every time. I'm like Linus, or isn't it Linus on Charlie? Oh, Charlie Brown. It ain't Linus. Charlie Brown. Yeah. We got a guy comes to church named Charlie Brown around here now, though. So, good morning. I don't know. I like to small talk with you a little bit. Yeah. Just stuff's going so crazy. It winter snapped back on us. Is that right or not right? Or can you believe that? 53 today? Yeah, I could snap back again. 53 today, I think they said. Is it warming up at all out there? No, not really. 60 tomorrow? By the end of the week, have you heard 95? And no. That's not true. Preacher's lying. Thanks for coming. I'm so glad you came to church. Some new folks with us today. I hope you enjoy church. We take our relationship with the Lord very, very seriously, but we like to goof around a bunch too. So hope you enjoyed that music. I will tell you, Renew Strength Church right now has some amazing, amazing kids programs. We've done a lot of work there to improve our kids programs. If your kids are in here, there's some good programs upstairs for them right now. You don't have to take them. It's your child. You can keep them. But if you want to give them away for a little while, we'll give them back. I promise, if you leave your child here, I will personally deliver them back to you. We don't keep kids here. We don't do that. Jamie and I, a couple of times, have left church. We never have ever driven together, so she thought I was bringing a kid. I thought she was bringing a kid. The kid was out playing basketball. Get home. Did you bring home Connor? So, anyhow, that just happens. What else do I want to say to you? I don't know what to say to you. What do you want me to say? Good morning. Thanks. Thank you. I know you got to get up and get dressed and get in the car and come to church, and you drove past some churches. Thank you for choosing this one this morning, okay? And I hope today my heart is that I can speak something to you today, that just speak some truth to you, speak something that really helps you on the inside. I'm not trying to impress you. I'm just trying to go after your heart, really, to be honest with you. I'd like to speak something to you today that you think about during the week. Okay? Let's pray together. Father, we're thankful this morning for your goodness. Thank you for that good music. Thank you, Lord, for everybody, Lord, in this building that participates in the ministry we do on a Sunday morning. Very grateful, Lord, for you. Pray for those that are in the hospital. Pray for those that aren't well today. Some are home, Lord, recovering. Some face surgery this week, Lord. They're heavy on our hearts today because we care about them and know that they're nervous, and pray, Lord, for their help and strength through a hard time ahead. But in this moment, Lord, I pray for just exactly what we're doing just now. As we open your word, Lord, may it just feed us something, Lord, do amazing and wonderful things in our life. We consider these moments, Lord, times of just precious times where we pick up things, Lord, that are very valuable. So, God, would you use a preacher today to give us some really valuable things that help us in understanding of how you work, who you are, why things sometimes are the way they are. Would you open our eyes, Lord, that we might know you more, and use these minutes, God, for something amazing. We'll give you thanks and praise for that. In Jesus' name, amen. Acts chapter 26, verse 12. We're actually not going to leave what we talked about last week too much. Last week we talked about a guy named Saul who had an experience along the road. A bright light, boosh, hit him. Every time I do that, I spit a little. A bright light hit him. He wakes up, and our big message last week is, and we're going to see it again here real quick. Maybe I should read it first, but why are you wrestling with God? Why are you wrestling with God? Let's read a minute and we'll get going. While they thus occupied. Now, I got to set you up here. Acts 26 is Paul retelling his story in front of King Agrippa. Now, King Agrippa was interested in his story, first of all, and had plans to let him go. But Paul appeals to Rome because God had a plan for him to go to Rome. Does that make sense? No, it makes sense. Okay. But Paul here is recounting that Acts chapter 9 event that happened, and he's telling it in his words. We'll pick up there. While thus occupied, as I journeyed to Damascus, with authority and commission from the chief priest, next, at midday, O king, along the road I saw a light from heaven, brighter than the sun, shining around me and those who journeyed with me. Go. And when we all had fallen to the ground, I heard a voice speaking to me, saying in the Hebrew language, Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? It is hard for you to kick against the goads. And we talked about that last week. We talked about it when it happened in Acts chapter 9. Again, it's a moment here where we can stop and say, why do we wrestle with the Lord? Why are we against what the Lord wants to do that's good in our life? Does that make sense? Lord, give me some understanding over the years. And I try to keep some things simple. I'm not a guy that makes things really complicated. Try not to, at least. 0 to 6, you learn everything. You know that, right? 0 to 6, you learn everything. 6 to 19, you form the patterns of your thinking. By the time you're 19 years old, you're cooked. Right? I always say it like this. God gave us good parents, a mom and a dad, really, to be very instructable in those moldable years of our lives. You get that? There are years in our lives that we're very moldable. Our grandkids were over again last night, and that's just a wonderful thing. It's just a wonderful thing. That caught me by surprise so much, I can't even tell you. But in those years, their young years in their life, they are so moldable. They are so pliable. You can speak in, you can really bring correction to them. You can get them speaking the right things, the wrong things. You can help them. You can challenge their thinking. You can correct them if they do wrong behavior, all those things. And they learn, and they're supposed to in those years, even up through the teenage years, hey, be corrected by good parenting so those patterns of our thinking are good. That makes sense? Now, for some of us, that happened, right? I will tell you, for me, my childhood was kind of a mess. I just, real quick, my dad was an only child, didn't have a dad. How good are dads when they don't have dads? He didn't have a clue what he was doing. Had no idea. He had anger issues and pornography issues in his life. Wow, awesome, huh? Pretty awesome. My mom was, how do I say this? Jim's back there. My mom isn't here this morning, so I can talk about her. And I think the best way to describe my mom was loved by her father and despised by her stepmother. Now, I should say, she was adopted. She was a product of an affair, and a husband came home from war and realized this baby wasn't his, and he was furious and basically threw her out of the house. And she was adopted by a Eastern Kentucky family that had no children. She was adored by dad, and mom got jealous of her. And mom treated her terribly when dad wasn't around, and treated her very differently when dad was. And my mom is just trying to get out of the house, man. I mean, my mom's trying to escape her family. That's what's happening here. She just wants to get away from her mom that's really kind of abusive to her, both physically and emotionally. First guy that comes along, happened to be my dad, they marry. They didn't get along from minute one. You know how they say the first year is the hardest? Well, their first 26 were all bad, for the most part. 20-some years are bad. Woken up many times, mom throwing dishes. That's what she would do to get my dad's attention. My dad just didn't care, didn't want to listen to her. So she'd throw dishes. Dishes breaking. That's a great thing for kids to hear. Isn't that a great thing for you to hear? Isn't that what you want your kids to hear? Yelling and screaming and dishes breaking. Can I just tell you how much I don't usually tell this story. I tell it in jail often, but how much an influence a parent can be in your life? We used to be, three of us boys used to be, you can imagine in that kind of upbringing, we were just handfuls, you know what I mean? I always say this story that we had a willow tree in our front yard. And my mom switched us with switches until there was no more reachable branches. And at one point in my life, because we had ADD, HPT, LSD, QQAR, the whole thing. What's the seniors club? AARP. We had all that. And my mom got frustrated and was just beating us every day, whipping us every day. One day she pulled a piece of paper out of a notepad, slammed that thing down on the table, and looked at us kids that were hyperactive and said, "Draw!" That would switch me. Please switch me. Give me a switching. That's over with quick. I got to draw and sit here and draw. But we got in trouble every day. And mom started making us draw every day. Just to make the story quick. In high school, I had an opportunity to draw in some drafting classes. Had some of the top drawings in Ohio. Tested out of 7 Ohio State drafting classes. Worked on a drawing board as a profession for 7 years, became the top drafter, top employee of the year in a company because my mama threw a piece of paper in front of me and said, "Draw," every day as a punishment. But we started drawing. If you're a parent here today, I just want to tell you, don't be afraid to correct your children when they're wrong. Hey, and love them and love them and love them and love them. What they say is it takes about 7 lovin's for every negative in their life. So you got to do a lot of loving to do it healthy and right. That makes sense? But correct your children, hey, so they'll be very healthy as they grow up. We're in a broken society now where it's just off the hook. You know what I mean? might say, where am I going with this whole thing? Well, by the time we're 19 years old, we're pretty programmed. Just like a computer comes with programs installed on it, it acts a certain way when given a certain stimulus, you know, and just like you do the same thing. Those patterns were set when you were teenagers, and often, that's why it's so hard, how do I say this? It's so hard for us to continue to make the same mistakes over and over and over and over again in life until something happens to cause us to be made different. And I always tell people, the best way to be made different is for Jesus to come in, because Jesus goes after all those things parents were after in a very loving way, corrective way. Hey, because he loves us. And obviously, that's what happened here to Saul, because, how do I say this to you? Saul was raised as a Pharisee. He was raised a hardcore Jewish guy, legalistic to the hilt. I don't know if you've been around legalistic people. They're very rules oriented. They're very much, you got to follow my rules. It got to be like this. You got no place to breathe because you got to be. And that's how he was raised. In fact, as he's talking to King Agrippa here, he talks about how he was raised in this sect of Pharisees that were super strict. And that's how his programming became, you know what I mean? So it was nothing for him when these Christians come along. He's saying, no, that's not the legalistic way we do it. Give me orders, I'll go kill them. And that's the mindset he's in when he's going up the road. And a light, bam! See, I believe for all of us, there's a moment in our life where God wants to reveal a bunch of stuff to us. The Lord, in that moment, he wants to begin to work that change in us from that brokenness that was in us from our upbringing. That makes sense? Everybody get that? We have an adversary, an enemy that tries to destroy us. I think today, just in sensing what's happening in our church today, I think there's a lot of people feel like they're under an attack. That makes sense? And I will tell you that if you're living for God, there are moments when the enemy attacks you. The sad thing is, the Bible very clearly says he strategizes against you. The enemy plans against you. That makes sense? The enemy's been watching. It's my belief the devil can't be everywhere because he's not omni-nothing like God is. But he has enough demons to watch everywhere. And I'll tell you, if you're a believer, the enemy's watching you. And what he's watching you for is for your weak spot. Right? And he'll wait and wait and wait. I've heard John before be up there in a tree stand, you know, with a deer, you know, in his sights. And John, I said the thing the first service, have you heard that? John don't take no butt shots. Is that right? I don't know how to say that. Forgive me for my... But John waits on a shot that's going to kill. Is that not true? I've heard you say you're in a tree stand and stuff, big stuff's right below you, but you couldn't get the right shot on it, and you weren't going to just wound it. Your desire was to kill it, right? So you miss a shot, not take a shot, because you couldn't. And the enemy's the same way, although he's perfectly okay with wounding too. But he's trying to deliver a fatal blow to kill you. The enemy comes to kill, steal, destroy. Get that? So Saul here has this programming in him. There it is, and all of a sudden a light comes and bang! And all of a sudden the Lord begins what he begins to do in every one of us. He begins to deal with us on the issues. And the first issue is, Saul, why are you fighting against me? I love you. I've always loved you. Sometimes we start fighting against the Lord because spiritual things sometimes counter our flesh things. That makes sense, Lord? It's funny how we can be such a Christian, but when it comes to certain things in our life, our flesh tends to win. You know what I mean? As a Christian, I'm going to get a bunch of trouble. I'm going to not go there. Should I not go there? Where I find in this day, really bad, more than any, you know, this whole marriage thing, you know, I know society and what Christians want to do is say, well, it's okay in society to live together for a while or to be active for a while and not be married. And there's a whole bunch of stuff we say it's okay when it's not okay. because the society's okay with it, but God isn't okay with it, you know what I mean? And the Lord, even though we can be big Christians in a lot of areas, our flesh still wants to be okay, or okay things that aren't okay. You get that? And in other areas of our life, sometimes we do that stuff. Does that mean everybody get that whole thing? And the Lord's saying, why are you kicking against me? Why are you fighting with me? I'm the one that loves you. I got a plan for your life. I'm for you, not against you. If I could get you to understand that today, that God in heaven has been for you from forever. He knows your name. In this particular thing, he calls his name. Saul had never really cried out to Jesus ever before, but Jesus is calling his name. Everybody hear that? Yeah? You think the Lord knows your name? I have stories where I know he knows my name. Next verse. So I said, who are you, Lord? I still crack up at that. I cracked about that last week. Who are you, Lord? And he said, I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting. What? I'm Jesus. You're messing with me. Why are you fighting against me? I know that applies to us. I just know it does. The Lord's got great things for you. Got great things for you. He has great things for you. He thinks you're amazing. You're his creation. I don't know. When I look in the mirror, I'm not that excited. There's times that I know I got some imperfections and I handled some things wrong, or this thing or that thing. Hey. But in spite of all that, the Lord's always loved me. He's always loved me. Always. It's funny how I can look at you. I can look at so many of you and just look at you and say, you're wonderful. You are wonderful. And you don't even think that thing about yourself. That guy right there is wonderful. That guy right there, yellow butterfly in her shirt right there. That guy right behind her is wonderful. Cool hair, by the way. And that girl right behind her, that Tana girl right there, right by her. That girl's wonderful. I probably should go back. Then Cheryl, then right on back through there. Miranda, hi. Erica's way back there. She's tailing up. Is Kim back there? Hey, there's Kim. Wonderful. I just mentioned some girls' names. I just want you to know something. I'm so thrilled you ladies are in our church. You guys are wonderful. Cheryl Cruz, I say this about Cheryl Cruz all the time. Every place Cheryl goes, there's something beautiful happening. Every place she goes. Love Cheryl, trust Cheryl. As far as I'm concerned, the church ought to give Cheryl a blank check because she could just do good with it. You know what I mean? Now, I wouldn't say that to everybody, but for Cheryl. Chuck, the amazing things the Lord's done in your life. Isn't that true? Can't you tell? Isn't it where you were and where you are now? Isn't it wonderful? Nate's getting married, coming up here. Isn't it amazing what God had planned for you? Isn't Lindsay amazing? Isn't she amazing? She sung a couple weeks ago. Wasn't that great? Libby's about to have a baby. Aren't we excited about that? Are we not excited about that? I'm so excited, but I can't stand that. It's awesome. One great way to build a church is have babies. Hey, they count, though. Babies count. In fact, I think we believe that baby's a living being now. We ought to count that in the church numbers right now, right? Don't you think? Right in the belly. Just count it. I got some guys on that row right there. I hope they're figuring out they're amazing. I hope they do. It's true. But at some moments in our life, before we have some understanding of who God is, we tend to fight against him. We tend to run away from him. A man that's in our house right now attended a church, and people were so legalistic and so nasty to him, he never wanted to go back to church again. He came in here, said, man, people are so friendly and nice here. He loves it here. In fact, he's trying to get a bunch of his friends to come to church here. Why are we fighting against Jesus? preaching last week's sermon. Let's get going here. Next one. Go. Man, this is a verse right here. This is... But rise and stand on your feet. Not literally. You can stay seated. Just every part of this verse, just... This is the verse today. I just want you to know, this is an amazing, amazing verse. This one and the next one. And stand on your feet, for I have appeared to you for this purpose. The Lord's trying to wake us up for a purpose. Man did a purpose, what's that called? Purpose-driven life. Listen to me, and that's all true. God, this great God of heaven, created everybody in this place because you have a purpose. You have a purpose. God created you with purpose. With a godly purpose. You get that? In this congregation right here, there are people here that can sing. And then there are people here who can't sing. There's butchers and bakers and cabinet makers in this place. I'm telling you, there's all kinds of talent and all kinds of, there's servers, there's prophets, there's givers, there's lovers, there's encouragers, there's hospitality people, there's all kinds of, go on and on and on and on in this place. We're just rich. We are so rich. I always think about when I look on the stage at the musical talent the Lord has given us. I just think, Lord, that is just a type of what is also sitting here in our church. We got a couple farmers here that are so stinking amazing they can do about anything. We got some intellectuals around here. Their brain scares me. They're so smart. You know what I mean? We got professionals. We got non-professionals. We got all kinds of everything here. I'm just telling you. And every variety of gift and talent in this church, we are loaded. We are talented to the gill. I'm just telling you. With loaded gifting in this place. We should be absolutely amazing for God. And we're figuring that out. And it's great. But every one of us were created for a purpose. An amazing godly purpose. Some serve in the church to encourage those that believe. Some have a purpose outside the church to really let their light shine. You understand that? To make you a minister and a witness, both of the things which you have seen. I like that. Because God wants to use everything that you have seen, everything that you've been through. You understand that? Everybody get that? At this moment in your life, God wants you to know you have purpose, and it's built on everything He's already revealed to you, every bit of experience you have already, everything that you kind of have knowledge of and understanding of. God wants you to use that all the time. Therefore, if you have a heroin problem, it's likely that God may use you to help people with heroin problems. If you've had marriage problems, listen, if you can cook, cook! If you could sing, sing! If you could preach, preach! Hey, if you can just love and encourage, because we need a whole bunch of covert just lovers of people around here that just love from person to person and care. We need cart senders. We need... Lady walked in today. I caught a conversation. She was upset about... She was getting out of her car and somebody attacked her in the parking lot. I said, tell me who that person is, because I'll snap their neck. I said, no, I'll back that off. I'll just give them a chiropractic adjustment. That's what I'll do. And it's here. It's all here. Hey, since you're walking around. No. What's your purpose? You know what your purpose is? What are you good at? Yeah. I think you are in a been through some awful hard things, haven't you? You have. This week, I heard you. We're listening. You just have to get up. Come up here. Come this way as far as you can so they can see you.
Yeah.
Okay? That ain't much, but it'll do. I'm kidding about people seeing it and not that exciting. Never mind. I'm just making a joke. You're about like me, right? It's in our heart. Yeah. And now I'm in trouble and I'm trying to get out of it. Okay. He's been through a hard week working this week. Can I tell you this? The enemy would love to discourage the heck out of him because he's an encourager. He had a brother die in an accident, and it about killed us all. And the enemy just wants to knock the wind out of our sails. You hear me? But he stood right here just now. He said he's a welder. I don't care much about that. Even though that pays the bills, right, brother? What I do care about is you're an encourager. In the body of Christ, you're an encourager. And you know what? I'm an encourager. You know that? You know I am too. And you know what? What happens to us often is we get attacked because the Lord doesn't want us to be encouragers. And you know how important it is for an encourager to be encouraged? I stopped you here today because I want to encourage you, okay? I heard your story there. Hey, care about you. Know exactly when you said it, what was happening. Listen, God's got a gifting and a talent for you, and an enemy just wants to beat you up all the time, right? So you got to trust in the Lord Jesus beyond the beat downs, right? To operate in the gift the Lord has for you, right? And that takes a pursuit of God. Hey, even when you're tired and discouraged, right? To stay working in the thing that God has gifted you to do, right? Just stay with it. Stay after it. Don't get discouraged because people need you to encourage them. And if you're discouraged,
I try to raise everybody around
me. Right.
Everybody.
Me too.
Yeah.
But work hard. Work hard at staying close enough to the Lord that the attacks of the enemy don't discourage you. Because you know,
yeah,
what comes upon us is discouragement, right?
Yeah.
It comes upon us. That's like where the enemy gets us.
Yeah.
Right? Now, that'll teach people to get Kleenexes. I'm just picking on. That's an encourager. I'm an encourager. Exactly what he deals with is what I deal with. Last night before church, I'm in a big old domestic thing where I find out stuff I don't want to find out. People are unfaithful and whole bunch of stuff going on. I'm in a big family argument scrub. You know, it's something that keeps me up at night. It just troubles me. The night before church, why? Because the enemy knew I was going to come preach something today that would bust him up. You know what I mean? So we got to do something to get that guy all bummed out, man. But arise and stand on your feet. That's kind of what I was saying to him. Don't quit, man. Don't quit. Don't stop. Just keep standing. Keep standing. Keep standing. Don't get knocked down. Don't quit. Don't become discouraged. Stand on your feet. Stand. For I have appeared to you for this purpose, to make you a minister and a witness both to the things which you have seen. Now we've covered that, the things you've been through. But this line, I love it. And of the things which I will yet to reveal to you. I will yet reveal to you. You see that? Everybody thinks I'm kind of weird, I think. I don't know. But in doing what I've done over the years and trying to challenge myself about really believing God for things that are in the Bible for me, not just reading things, but saying, God, if it's in there, it's for me. I've had some experiences in my life. I think I told you, I prayed for a man that was dead, and he lived another 11 years. I've had the Lord speak to me audibly twice. I can go on and on with things that have happened in my life where God just fully, completely revealed himself to me as being there. I stand on the stage today with the things that I have seen in my life, with a complete and total confidence that God is real and that his word is true. It's true. Every single bit of that is good for you. You make sense? God has a perfect will for your life. He says that because he's saying he wants you to walk out, run towards that perfect will. You know, it is in the scripture that you may be able to walk out or to walk out those things that are the perfect will of God. So God has a perfect will for your life. Everybody get that? And again, from our upbringing all the way to where we are, we got misprogrammed, all dysfunction, all messed up, all that stuff. You know, there are people here, man, you wouldn't know normal if normal, right? normal is abnormal for you. There's probably a level beyond that for some of us in here. Normal is, well, twisted. Right? I believe there are people. I was just trying to talk. There are people that are into drama because that's all they've ever known, and they don't even know they're drama people. You get that whole thing? They stir up drama all the time because that's just what they've always known, and they see that as normal, and they don't know it's not. So a lot of times you're dealing with people, oh my gosh, so much drama. I got some people that we deal with sometimes that are whiners. Whiners really irritate me. You ever been around a whiner? Oh my gosh. Whiners, oh man. Instead of looking at the, you know, instead of looking at the cup half full, they're looking at it empty all the time, or all, you know, and all, I don't know. I got people saying, I wish the Lord would just take my life. Oh, you're driving me crazy. I'd like to right now. Smack! Whine, 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 whine. I just want to stand in front of them sometimes and just go, I do that hee-haw thing, you know. Gloom, despair, and agony. Oh, yeah, you've heard that before. I say this in the jail a lot. God didn't put that mouth on the front of your face to destroy nothing or to tear down or to talk negative. God put that mouth in the front of your face to declare His goodness. Hey. And the plans for your life and over your family. Does that make sense? This mouth can speak. What the Bible say? That this mouth is like the rudder of your ship. That it steers your ship in the direction it's going to go. And whatever you speak, trust me, you'll live in that place. You got to that place by your own mouth. I'll just tell you that right now. And the mouth speaks out of the heart. So you ended up living right where your heart is. That makes sense? You end up where, but the things that the Lord may still reveal to us. I tell you, a lot of people don't realize this. Some people caught up in all this. In terms of the church, this is the most exciting time there's ever been or will ever be. You hear me? The Spirit of God, He said, I will pour out my Spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and daughters will prophesy. And y'all give you visions and dreams, and you're going to know me, man. I'm going to reveal myself to you in my power. I'm going to do many signs. He said, many things you will do, greater things will you do than I did. That's what He said. He was talking to us, by the way. And we can be old, I don't know how to say, old fiddlers, I guess, or just whiners or complainers or all those things and just miss everything God wants to do that's amazing. We forget that God created us for a purpose, and the things that we've seen He wants to use, and that there's still many, many things He still has to reveal to us, and that's going to be awesome. I'm not afraid to see. We're going to see great miracles. We're going to see great miracles. And people are going to go, whoa, not for today. Oh, yeah. Next verse. And I will deliver you from the Jewish people. Who were the Jewish people to Saul? They were his people. He was a Jewish person. There are a couple powerful verses right here. And so the thought is in this whole thing, so I'm going to deliver you from who you are. I'm going to deliver you from where you've been. You get that? Because Saul was a Jew. But with the Jews, he was a Pharisee that was really strict and legalistic, and he didn't get Jesus, and he didn't get what the Lord was trying to do. He didn't understand His purpose. And the Lord says, I'm going to deliver you from that. And I don't know if you're in here today. If you got issues, if you got things you're struggling with, the Lord wants to deliver you from that. God wants to deliver you from the place you've been and cause you to be a new creation. That's what God's trying to do. You can't put on new stuff in old wineskins. You know, you can't do heaven. You can't be old and expect God to do something new. You can't just be who you are and expect God to. But listen, when you're ready to go, the Lord's ready to deliver you. Sometimes with drug addiction, the guys say, man, people just got to get to the place where they want it. Well, I want to say that with Christians. Sometimes you guys got to get to the place where you want it. I just tell you, I left an engineering job that pastor a church here. Jamie and I were struggling terribly financially with that when we made that move. I didn't know what to do. I knew God had called me to something. I knew we were in trouble. I couldn't walk away when I knew God called me to do it. Jamie's doing everything she could do. We've always been workers. We work. Well, the only thing I needed to do, because I wanted something, I wanted God to deliver me from the fear, from the devil's foothold in my life, what the devil was saying to me. I wanted to, from just the struggle I had within me. The Lord needed to deliver from me from who I was to the place He was going to take me. He needed to deliver me from being Mark the old man to Mark the new man. There's a big culvert about half a mile down the road from my house. And I'd walk about every day down to that culvert or ride a bike down there. And I'd get out and I'd go in that culvert. It had a little stream trickling through it. Sometimes I'd take a piece of chalk. And I'd just write stuff and inside that culvert. I'd just give stuff to the Lord and inside that culvert. I'd just write stuff there. Nobody ever see it. I didn't want anybody to ever see it. And I would tell you, and I know this sounds crazy because there are not many people that probably could tell you this story, but in that culvert, the Lord began to deliver me from who I used to be and set me free from all my fears and all the stuff. He really turned me into this guy that says, Lord, you got me. I was convinced in my mind that I was in trouble and fear had set upon me and I needed direction and all kinds of stuff, but I had to get to the place where I really wanted to be delivered from who I used to be. And I started going to this culvert and just crying out to God there. What really amazed me was, as I would walk, as I would ride my bike or walk to that culvert, there was something that would rise up in me. I was just excited to be going. You know what I mean? It was a place where I knew God was going to meet me there. On Friday, a man in our church that's really turned on fire to the Lord Jesus brought a man that he'd been working with in here. And he said, you got to meet this pastor, but more than that, you got to meet the Lord. And we ended up, after talking a while, down here in this sanctuary on Friday, late on Friday, about 7:15, 7:30 on Friday. And because a man had begun to live out loud his Christian faith, he'd influenced another man who was going through some trouble. That man didn't know where to go for answers, so he came to talk to a pastor, and a pastor said, I can't fix it either, so let's just pray to God. We ended up down here on our knees praying, and in the middle of that thing, that man prayed a sinner's prayer. Service today with a big old smile on his face. Next Sunday after this service, we're going to baptize folks. You know that? You've never been baptized and trust the Lord and your Savior. Let's go. Okay? Sometimes you need deliverance from who you are. Well, God loved me just the way I am. That's true. God, I can come to the Lord just the way I am. But is God finished? No. God just began it on me. God is faithful to finish the thing He began in me, complete the thing, right? So God starts a work as I come to Him. Listen, and it's a work that has to happen in my mind. And I know if my mind changes, my whole life changes. There was a lady here in the first service. I talked about her at this point in the first service. She broke her leg 3 or 4 times. Just an elderly lady in her church, had no family. She didn't know how she was going to pay her bills. Every time she went to a nursing home, she went through that like three times. The fourth time it happened to her again, I remember going to the nursing home and she began to say, Mark, I can't go through this again. I don't know how I'm going to pay my bills. I just started laughing. Isn't it nice when your pastor's so comforting? And I said, you've been through this 3 times. God's going to get through And in that moment, something happened in her. And God delivered her from who she was. I don't know where you're at, and I don't know what you're struggling with, and this is really the point of this message today. You might be a devout Jew, or you might be a devout person. You might be a good person. That makes sense? But the Lord needs to deliver you from some stuff. You get that? He needs to get you out of who you are into who He wants you to be. A person of purpose. To use the things you have been and the things He's still going to reveal to you. Well, I'll just walk in this whole Christian thing and just be me. Okay, but the Lord's trying to work on you. Let Him deliver you from all your fears and all your failure and all your guilt. You know, there's people walking around with all kinds of stuff. The Lord wants to deliver you from all of that. You don't need to live in that. Listen, the work that happened on the cross and the resurrection of our Lord Jesus did the work that you could be forgiven, completely clean, delivered, healed, fixed. This body is a temporal thing. And as you get older, it'll fail you. Pray, and God may give you just a little more use of it. You know what I mean? But I'm often not even talking about that. I'm talking about what God wants to do on the inside. So many Christians need to be delivered from all the stuff they got going on so they just have a joy. So many Christians need to be delivered from so many things that have happened to them that they have a peace. So many Christians have so many broken things or wounds in them. They need to be delivered so bad that they need to come healing in them that they're healed. Sean told me this week, Sean, listen, can I have some liberty a little bit? His mother, is it okay? I'm not going to tell that story, but if you could have a mother that was, what's the word should I use? Just as bad a mother as you possibly can. And I'm not trying to be critical of his family. But at a point not that long ago, his hate and unforgiveness towards his mother, he came to the place where he let it go. Let it go. I told you about my mother being messed up as a child. My mom still holds on to some of that. I've looked at her and looked at her and looked at her and said, Mom, you got to let some of that go. You got to let that go. That was a long time ago. You're getting older now, Mom. You got to let that go. I don't know where you're at. I don't know what the enemy's trying to use in your life. You hear me? But he'll try to use it so strong in your life, you'll never see the purpose of God for your life, you know? And you need to be delivered. As well as from the Gentiles to whom I now send you. That sounds like you're getting sent in the lion's den right there. I'm just telling you. I'll deliver you from these people. I'm about to send you into them. I'm going to deliver you. Ooh, I'm about to send you someplace. I'm about to deliver you because they're going to be after you. And we know that Paul was stoned and left for dead and beaten. But the Lord just kept delivering. He got to the place where you know, it's pretty raw when you get to the place, hey, for me to live is Christ. But for me to die at this point is gain. Little Sammy right there. I'm going to deliver you. The words I see in that verse is, I'm going to deliver you and I'm going to send you. See that? I'm going to deliver you and I'm going to send you. Hello? My dad died in his 40s. What did the Lord do? First thing the Lord did? That same year, the Lord sent me on my first mission trip. I never look back. It's like the Lord, you can stay here and pout as long as you want to, but I got plans for your life. How long is this thing going to take, you know? As I'm speaking to students, how long does this process take? Does it take a while, or can you just begin to trust in the Lord and this can happen pretty rapidly in your life? Because what the Lord has done already is sufficient for the thing you need. You just got to want that. You got to want that enough to walk a half mile down to the culvert, you know what I mean? Or to sneak in here when the church doors are open and find a place in here to pray, or to just get alone with the Lord someplace early in the morning or late at night. You ought to be begging the Lord, "Lord, deliver me from me." That's what Christians need more than anything else, preach to them over and over. Just deliver me from me, Lord, because I'm the only thing holding you back in my life. Next verse, I got to quit here. This is our mission statement. I'm going to quit after this verse. That's our mission statement. To open their eyes in order to turn them from darkness to light. What's my purpose? To walk in these things of purpose, in the things I've seen and the things that are yet to be revealed, so that their eyes might be open in order to turn them from darkness to light, from the power of Satan to God. That they may receive forgiveness of sin and an inheritance among those who are sanctified by faith in me. Your job for the Lord. I'll do this again. I think I said something pretty profound a couple of weeks ago. I don't always do that, so I'm going to remind you of it. Every care and burden you have in this life, you got to learn this. The Lord said, "Cast your cares upon me, for I care for you." So the Lord wants us to cast every care we have on Him. He doesn't want us to be anxious. He says it all the time. Don't be anxious for nothing. He says 365 times in the Scripture, don't worry, don't be afraid. One for every day of the week, for every day of the year. The Lord wants you to cast every one of those cares on Him. He cares for you. And what the Lord wants to give you in exchange for that is a cross you carry for Him. He wants to give you your created purpose. So, Lord, all these worldly things, I cast them on you. Now, let me say this to you. If you're not doing right, that ain't going to work. But if you're trying to do right and you cast your cares upon Him, the Lord will care for you. There's a verse that says, if you'll seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, all these other things will be added unto you. If you're doing the right thing, have the right heart, God will help you. God will deliver you. You hear that? Everybody hear that? What was I? Oh. And the Lord will give you your purpose to carry it, a cross to carry. Married a couple last week in another church and across the front of the church. If you want to be my, I'll say it, something to the effect that the Luke verse, you must carry my cross if you want to be my disciple. Something to that effect. If you want to be my disciple, you got to carry my cross. So as a Christian, the Lord wants us to cast all our worldly cares upon Him. He'll care for us. And He wants us to pick up. The only burden we ought to carry is this burden of the ministry, the purpose ministry of our life. That's hard, but that's something the Lord requires of us. Hey, and hopefully as we carry that right into heaven, Lindsay drew me a picture of that. I've always said this. That's the cross we'll carry up to heaven's gates. We'll carry that cross right up to heaven's gates, you know, that cross of the burden that we carry for the Lord. And at the heaven's gate, we take that cross off. Hey, and throw it on a pile of crosses because the people in front of us all carry their cross there too. And when we walk in heaven, we don't have that cross to bear no more. And there'll be this great big pile of crosses outside heaven's gate where people walk through that cross all the way to heaven's gate. That's not in the Scripture, by the way. That's just something I'm telling you. You won't find that in Scripture. Hey, and behind you, hey, I get this. There'll be a whole bunch of people doing the same thing because you carried your. I didn't think it was fair, but the Lord called me to start a church. Why didn't He call you? And I had to cast my cares at that culvert one day. I had to cast my cares, all my worldly cares, I had to cast them away. And I had to pick up a cross to bear. That was a church. The Lord called me to start. Did everybody get that old thing? And I said, Lord, if you'll take my cares, I'll take that cross. Because in that moment, my cares looked bigger than that cross. I'll tell you, at this point, my cares back then were not as big as that cross. And I began to carry a cross that I still carry. But I hope there's a whole bunch of you that get to heaven someday, hey, because somebody carried a cross before you, and I hope you start picking up yours and carrying it so that many will be affected by the cross you carry. That their eyes might be opened, that they might be turned from darkness to light, and from the power of Satan to the power of God. See, some people have the power of Satan gripping them. Satan has tools he's using. He's using heroin. He's using all kinds of stuff. Tools of the devil. Listen, I just want to tell you something. If you're messing around with Satan and his power, you better get God, because you ain't strong enough on your own to fight with Satan. Says right there that they might be delivered from Satan to God. Satan's tools need to be broken by God, that they may receive forgiveness of sins. Isn't that amazing? That God might forgive us of our sins and have an inheritance. Look at that. Hey, and receive an inheritance just like you and me. That's our mission statement. What should we be doing? Right there. Now, hey, Beth, keep welding. Right? Carry your cross. That their eyes might be open, right? Chad, keep doing that job, that social work job, buddy. You know what I mean? Hey, same time. You got a mission. Shane, you're doing some plumbing, or Shane. Sean, you're doing some plumbing, right? I know you are already. You're going in every house. If they'll talk, buddy, you'll talk, right? I want you to know something. You have an earthly job that pays the bills. But your spiritual ministry is that verse right there. Lord, we thank you for time together today. Thank you for gathering these people. Thank you for putting the very words we need to see before us. And calls us, Lord, calls us all to live in purpose. That was always your design. That's always where you wanted us to be. That we might walk out your perfect will for our lives. There's some here, Lord, that don't have a clue how to get there. But if they want it, Lord, I just sense, Lord, today, if you'll just, God, compel them to want it, I also pray, God, that you'd meet them as they search you. Lord, as they walk down to their own culvert or they make their own place, God, I pray, God, that you would open up purpose, that you would not hide anything from your sons and daughters. That we would, Lord, be people who live in that verse. A verse of purpose, eternal purpose. That their eyes might be opened, that Satan may be defeated, that they might be forgiven and have an eternal reward. Cause us not to forget, Lord, there's a spiritual purpose for each one. Challenge us all of